To Luke chapter 5, please, if you would. Luke chapter 5. We're going to read a short story this evening, the story of a leper. And you can see from the PowerPoint, or at least I hope you can read that at home. The title is Lessons from the Leper. We have some really good insights in this passage of Scripture. Insights from an individual who was dirty and knew that he was. He needed to be healed. He needed to be cleansed. Insights into the Savior that spoke to him and cleaned him and exercised or gave him what he asked for as he exercised faith. And so let's read through the passage beginning in verse number 12. We're going to read verses 12 through 15, and then we'll come back and work our way through here and see what we can learn. It says this, and it came to pass when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And he put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he charged him to tell no man, but go and show himself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing, according as Moses commanded, for the testimony unto them. But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities. Our Father, we ask that you would open your word to us this evening and teach us the truths that you have for us. Lord, in this simple story of this leper, there is so much that we can see, Lord, that you want us to learn. And I ask that our eyes will be open and that our hearts will be open and that your Holy Spirit will do his work within us as we allow him, Lord, please. Draw us closer to you, encourage us, and challenge us, we pray. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Well, the first thing we're going to do, or the first person we're going to look at, is the leper. And so in verse number 12, it says, insights into the leper. I want you to notice some things about this leper. First of all, he realized that he needed to be cleaned. He needed to be cleansed. He had come to the point where that he knew that he was dirty. And this is the place, let me say, that we must come to before we can receive cleaning, cleansing. If we do not see ourselves as in need of being cleaned by the Savior, we will never see the need to come to the one who can clean. I've said this before, but I feel that this is very important for us to understand that there are some people that just need to get lost before they can get saved. They have a lot of faith in themselves. They have a lot of dependency upon their own work. And this leper was in a situation where he could not help his condition. He was diseased and he needed to be cleansed, and he knew that he couldn't do it on his own. And so he came to the Savior. So there was a recognition of his condition. And the Bible tells us that when he came, he was full of leprosy. Let's understand the extent that sin is within us. It runs deep within our flesh. And there are things that we may not even realize about ourselves that are the result of our sin nature. This man was full of leprosy. Just like you and I are full of the disease of sin. It is within us. And it is what makes up our flesh. And he recognized that. And the Bible says, as he came to Jesus, he fell on his face. I want you to notice there was real humility as he came to the Savior. Now, this is some pretty graphic explanation here. He fell on his face. Now, I'm sure you can picture this. You can see this man coming to Jesus Christ. He's full of leprosy. This is a man that nobody wanted to be around. And actually, he was supposed to stay away from others because of the contagious nature of this disease. And isn't it interesting that our sin can affect others around us without us even trying? But this man came and he fell on his face before Jesus Christ. You can literally picture this man coming up and falling down with his face in the dirt before Jesus Christ. He had a deep sense of humility. He knew where he was in this life, and he understood who Jesus was and where he was. And when we have this same vision, we have a deep sense of humility, then it affects the way we approach our Savior. We do it with our faces down. And I'm not saying that we have to come to Christ or that we can't come to Christ with our eyes uplifted and our hands uplifted, because in the scripture we have examples of that going on and lifting up holy hands. And so those things can happen, but I'm talking about a spirit and an attitude of humility when we enter into the presence of Jesus Christ. Have you ever heard people pray and it sounds like they're commanding God to do something? God, I want you to do this, and God, I want you to do that. God, I expect you to do this, and I expect you to do that. And I'm not undermining faith, but what I'm saying is that we need to enter into God's presence with a sense of knowing who he is and who we are, and there needs to be humility. We're invited to come boldly before his throne, and I thank God for that invitation. But when we truly understand our humble estate, it affects the way we approach our Savior, and it affects the way we approach each other as well, right? When there's humility within our lives, it affects the way that we approach each other and that we look at each other. And I want you to know here also that he came to the only one who could cleanse him. He came to Jesus. Jesus was the only one. You can't come to me and expect to be healed. I can't go to you and expect to be healed. My friend, we must point people to Jesus. I'm reminded of this verse in John chapter 12 and verse number 32, where Jesus said, "And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me." Now we understand that he was talking about the cross, but there's some imagery in this verse of scripture. He needed to go to the cross, and he needed to be lifted up and die for our sins, and he needed to purchase our salvation. But he says, in being able to do that, he will draw all men unto him. What does he mean? He means he purchased the salvation for all men. He is the only one that could do that. And this leper recognized that. People are looking for peace, and many, especially at this point in our nation, and where, not just our nation, but around the world, many are living in fear. And there's only one person who can give them the longing of the human soul that they have, and that is Jesus Christ. And so this leper came to the right person, and he came to the only one that could heal him. So he knew his condition. He came in complete humility, and he came to the only one that could help him. But I also want you to notice that there are some words in here, Christians, that we need to take note of. I see two key words at the end of this phrase. The leper says this, "Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean." Oh, we can dissect that phrase and we can learn all kinds of things from it, but there are two words in particular that I want you to notice. The first one is the word wilt. Lord, if thou wilt. Lord, if you will do this. Lord, if you will. If this is within your will. This is a word that teaches us a submission to God's will. This leper knew his condition. He knew who he was coming to. And he had faith that Jesus could do it, but he submitted to the will of Jesus. He said, if you will. There's a recognition here. I want you to understand that as this leper said this, there is a recognition, and you can see it in the way that he phrased this. There's a recognition that he is undeserving of the very favor that he was asking for. Lord, if you will. This is not a demand. This is a request. This is a plea. And then he says, I know that thou canst. I know that you can do it. This is a statement of complete faith. There's a statement of complete faith in this. A recognition of the power of Jesus Christ and what he is capable of doing. Now listen to me, Christian. These two truths are a great lesson for us. And as a matter of fact, as we work our way through this passage and get near the end of this sermon, this truth is going to come up again. But there are two truths right here, a submission to God's will and a statement of complete faith, all contained within this plea by this leper. God may choose to deliver us from difficult times, or he may choose to let us go through difficult times in order to grow us, or allow us to go through difficult times so that we can be a living example for others to see. But that is left up to his will to determine. What we need to do is exercise the faith. I know you can. If this is within your will to do it, I have complete confidence. I have faith in you, God, to choose which one you want to do. But I know that you can, and I leave it up to you. What a statement of faith. What a statement of submission that this man had. And he was in a dire strait. He could not live a normal life. He lived a life of isolation. It was a life that was dependent upon the goodwill of others to even provide for him. And here was a man who is much worse off, physically speaking, than what you and I would be. But yet he submitted to God's will and exercised faith at the same time. What an insight into this man. But then we get into verses 13 and 14 and we see insights into the Savior, Jesus Christ. It says in verse number 13, and he put forth his hand, this is Jesus, Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. Jesus responded to this man's faith. Jesus responded to this man's faith. Faith moves our master. You realize that? Faith moves our master. I got ahead of myself with the PowerPoint. But before we look at the point that's there, I just want to say a couple more comments about this idea of Jesus responding to this man's faith. I'm not talking necessarily about faith that God will deliver, but faith that God can deliver and knows what is best. And I think that that's key to this passage. As this man prayed, I know that if thou wilt, that thou canst. It's understanding that God knows what is best. Faith that says, I know you can, but I yield to your will. And that kind of faith moves our Savior. Now, verse number 14, we see something that really should grab our attention, Christian. And he charged them to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing, according as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. Now, at the ministry of Jesus Christ, they were living under the Old Testament economy. I believe what we have as Jesus was on the earth was the beginnings of the church, the conception of the church. I believe the church was born on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came and entered into that body of believers. I believe that was the birthing of the church. But during the time that Christ walked on the earth, they were under the Old Testament economy. And what is it that Jesus tells him to do here? Jesus directs him to obey the scripture. Don't let this pass you up. This is it may seem like an insignificant part of this passage, but this is so important for us to note here, believer. God's will never leads us to contradict a clear teaching from his word. It never does. God will never direct us into a situation where we have where we are justified to contradict a clear teaching of his word. Never. And as Jesus looked at this man, he directs him to obey the Old Testament scripture. Now, you may not be familiar with the scripture, but in the Old Testament, if a leper was healed of his leprosy, God had actually built into the law, this is how you're supposed to respond. You go see the priest checks it out, and you come back later, and the priest checks it out, and if it all is legitimate and you truly are healed, you offer a sacrifice, and God had it all laid out. And he's directing this man to do that. God always directs us into his word. If you are considering a move or an opportunity, I don't mean necessarily a move into a different location, but if you're considering a move in your life and you're making a decision and you have to make a choice to do this or to do that, and there's some activity that you're planning in your life, and that move or that decision actually causes you to violate principles of God's word, you can try to justify it all you want to, but it is not scriptural. God never leads us to contradict his word. And so we have a principle here for us, Christian, that is good for us to learn. But I want you to notice at the end of verse number 14 that as he directs him to go to the priest, the last phrase he says, for a testimony unto them. Now, part of that may be the fact that the priest had to give the final approval that the man was cleansed. But I honestly think what that passage is teaching us is that Jesus wanted this man to be a testimony to the priests. Now, understand, or maybe I should just put it in the way of a question. When do you think the last time was that the priest that was alive at that period of time saw a leper cleansed? Probably never. Probably never. Now, the principle I want us to see here is this. Our life is to be a testimony to others. Our life is to be a testimony to others. This priest believed. They believed that only God could heal a leper. And now they see Jesus Christ had done it. It was a testimony to the deity of Jesus Christ, the power that God had given him, that he was sent by God Almighty to this earth. It was a testimony. And it had to be witnessed by the priest. He had to admit it. He had to declare it. It was just as plain as the nose on their face. I wonder if this priest actually had to look it up in the Old Testament just to see exactly how he was supposed to handle it, because he had never seen one of these cases before. It was a testimony to Jesus Christ. And I think we need to understand that God wants our lives to be the same. Now here we see a key principle in surrendering to God's will. This may sound like a repeat, but I want us to understand that I see that in this passage here as well. Sometimes God delivers so that others can see our testimony for him. And sometimes God does not deliver so that others can see our testimony for him. And you may say that sounds like a contradiction. No, it is God's choice. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 11, please. Hebrews chapter 11. I want you to see in this passage, this chapter that is often referred to as God's Hall of Faith, this great chapter on faith. And we're going to turn to the end of the chapter. In Hebrews chapter 11, we have this great listing of individuals who conquered kingdoms and who did great things. It says in verse 33, who through faith subdued kingdoms. And in verse 34, quenched the violence of the fire. Verse 35, women received their dead raised to life. And we have this listing of magnificent things that were done through these people and for these people by God Almighty because of their faith. That faith that we preached on a couple weeks ago, that God can work through it, that faith that is the pipeline for the power of God in our lives. But I want you to notice verse number 36, where it says, and others. We have this list of all these victors throughout this chapter. And then he gets to verse 36 and he says, and others. Who are the others? These are the ones that had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings. Moreover, of bonds and imprisonments, they were stoned and sawed asunder and tempted and slain with the sword. And he lists all of these afflictions that these individuals went through. Why is it that God did this for some of them and gave them deliverance, but for others God did not give deliverance? You and I may never know the whys and all of that, but what we do understand is that God knows what's best, and he chooses according to his will, so that it will be a testimony for him. In some of these cases, God delivered so that the lives of these people could be a testimony for God. In some of these cases, God chose not to deliver so that their life could be a testimony for God. You see, regardless of what we go through, God wants us to exercise faith. We know He can deliver if it's within His will to deliver. Look at verse number 39 to get the full impact. And these, do you notice the next three-letter word? All. These all, having obtained a good report through faith. And then he goes on and finishes his thought. But I want you to notice how God grouped them. God did not say, these received special treatment. These did not. No. God said, all of them received a good report. They obtained it through faith. That's what we're talking about here. Well, go back with me to our passage in the book of Luke. Luke chapter 5. And let's look at verse number 15. Luke 5 and verse number 15. Where it says this, "But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear, and to be healed by him of their infirmities." What do we see here? We see one man's testimony affected many. You know, this is the result that Jesus wanted. The results of this man's healing yielded the exact result that Jesus wanted. You may never know this side of heaven how many people are affected by your testimony. If God puts you in a very difficult situation in your life and others see you go through that, you will never know. You will never know who watched you and who saw that and who saw Jesus through you because of your faith. If God chooses to deliver you, you need to thank God for it, you need to praise Him for it, and you need to be very vocal about the fact that your faith was in God so that others could see Jesus through you because of your faith. You know, the three Hebrew children went through the fire, right? The three Hebrew children went through the fire, and they did not know how many generations would be challenged and encouraged by their stand against the king's decree. As a matter of fact, go with me to Daniel chapter 3, and we'll wrap up this evening by looking in the book of Daniel at that particular passage. We're in Daniel chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading in verse number 17. We have here King Nebuchadnezzar that makes this great image of himself and commands everyone in his kingdom to bow down before this image. The three Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, refused to bow the knee. They would not worship this God. They worshiped Jehovah only. And they faced the fire because of it. And I want you to notice how they addressed King Nebuchadnezzar. They did it respectfully, but they did it firmly. And in verse number 17, it says, "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." That's a beautiful answer. If it be so, our God is able. But if he doesn't deliver us. And it's interesting here. He says he will deliver us out of thine hand. One way or the other, king, we're not bowing before your image. Our great God is either going to take us home to be with him, or he's going to take us through this fire. We know he can do whatever he wants to do. But it's up to him to choose. And I think that's the truth that I'm trying to teach us this evening. Either way, God is able. We leave it up to him to decide how he can best get the glory in each situation. And it may be as we go through this pandemic that God would allow one of our church family members to get sick. So far as I know, we've not had any of our church family get sick with coronavirus. And I'm very grateful for that. And I pray that God will keep us from that. But it may be that God would allow one of us to go through it. I don't know. And it's up to God to decide how he can best get the glory in that situation. It is up to him. We continue to pray. We continue to surrender. But you know what our job is? Be faithful. Because regardless of whether God delivers us or not, our life is to be a testimony for him. Would you bow your head with me this evening, please? Our great God, we want to thank you for this passage that we looked at this evening from Luke chapter 5. We thank you for this leper who had the faith to come to Jesus Christ. This man that knew that Jesus could heal him, but submitted to his will as to whether or not he would. Father, what a key principle that we see all throughout your scripture. Lord, help us to understand that if you allow us to go through a difficult time, it's not because you don't love us, Lord. It's because you want us to exercise faith in such a way that it brings glory to you. God, one of your greatest servants, Job, went through such a terrible time. But you knew when you put him into that or allowed him in to go through that, that he was a godly man. And look at the testimony that we have today because of what he went through. Father, may our faith be completely in you, even as Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Lord, may our faith be such that we can say, Lord, we know that you can, but it's up to you whether you decide whether you will or not. And Lord, may our faith be in you and in your ability to get glory in our lives. And may our testimony do just that, bring honor and glory to you. And Father, we pray these things now in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.